It's Pon Farr night at the Vulcan nightclub. Season 2 opens with Bones stopping Jim in the hallway to discuss Spock. Their Vulcan friend has apparently been acting strange as of late, agitated, moody, decreased appetite. They catch Chapel heading to Spock's room with a bowl of homemade Vulcan plomeek soup, which I guess is the Vulcan equivalent to chicken noodle. Bones gently ribs Chapel about her crush on Spock. Seconds later, an enraged Spock throws the bowl of soup at the wall, screaming at Chapel to leave him alone, stunning everyone. He then demands Jim give him permission to take a leave of absence to go back home to Vulcan. Jim wants an explanation as to Spock's outlandish behavior, to which Spock offers none, clearly hiding something, but desperate to go home. Finally, Jim drops it, just wanting his friend to be alright again, and orders the course change to Vulcan. Throughout the whole conversation, Spock is gripping a knife behind his back, shaking. On the bridge, we're finally introduced to the seventh cast member of the original series, a young man named Ensign Chekov. Gene Roddenberry decided to add on a younger cast member to pull in a younger audience, even going so far as to fit actor Walter Koenig with a wig reminiscent of English pop band The Monkees. Koenig was hired to fill in for George Takei some of the time because Takei was filming a John Wayne movie. You may have heard a story about the decision to make Chekov Russian, but as a result of a Soviet newspaper at the time criticizing Star Trek for neglecting to include Russian representation. As far as I can tell, this is largely apocryphal, with both Koenig and William Shatner claiming it to be made up. But the idea that Roddenberry wanted to show both sides of the Cold War, united in the future by adding a Russian character, makes for a nice story. Kirk receives orders from Starfleet Command to go directly to Altair 6, since there's some important diplomatic function happening that requires the presence of the Federation flagships. Jim apologizes to Spock, promising to let him go home after the ceremony is over. However, Jim later finds out that Spock has ordered Helm to divert to Vulcan against his and Starfleet's express orders. When Jim questions him about it, Spock claims not to remember giving the order and begs for Jim to confine him to quarters, remaining cryptic about his condition. Jim, frustrated with his secretiveness, orders him to sickbay.
Come in, Spock. I'm all ready for you.
My orders were to report to sickbay, Doctor. I have done so. And now I'll go to my quarters.
Spock is the funniest character on this show. I don't care what you say. After doing a full examination, Bones comes to Jim with disturbing news.
You'll die, Jim.
Dramatic copyrighted music! Spock is in his quarters, studying a photo of a young Vulcan girl when Jim comes to him, pleading with him to tell him what's killing him. There's a sense of shame and devastation in Spock, and once again, he's shaking and holding the knife. Spock tells Jim that it's a deeply private matter known only to Vulcans, or non-Vulcan spouses of Vulcans. Jim swears that he won't tell a soul, and Spock finally relents.
It has to do with biology.
What kind of biology?
Vulcan biology.
You mean...
biology. Out of Vulcan?
Biology as in...
You did not misunderstand that. Spock literally has to f*** someone, or he will die. Welcome to Star Trek. Spock explains that he's going through something called Pon Farr, a psychological consequence for Vulcans of constantly suppressing their emotions. Every 7 years, the blood fever consumes them and causes madness, and will kill them unless they do... the sex. So Spock has to go home and get married, to a woman his parents chose for him at age 7, essentially an arranged marriage. You know, I get that Vulcans value their privacy, and this is considered shameful to them, but you would think that this would be the kind of vital medical information Starfleet would have on file. Spock is definitely not the first Vulcan who's enlisted in the fleet. Jim promises that he'll get Spock to Vulcan at any cost. He asks Admiral Komek for permission to divert to Vulcan without giving away Spock's dilemma, to which Komek says no. Nevertheless, Jim decides to go to Vulcan anyway, even though it's disregarding direct orders and will probably mean the end of his career. This is not the last time Jim will risk everything for Spock.
I can't let Spock die, can I, Bones? I owe my life a dozen times over. Isn't that worth a career?
So yeah, remember how we've established that the Enterprise and Jim's captaincy are the most important things to him in life? There's one more thing that's more important to him. Chapel, who overhears this whole exchange, goes to Spock's quarters to tell him the good news. Spock, who is well aware of her feelings for him, tries to let her down gently. It's a real humanizing moment for him.
Your face is wet.
Yeah, I bet that's not the only thing. There's nothing in this. Spock asks Jim and Bones to accompany him to the service, to be his groomsmen of sorts. As they reach Vulcan, they receive a communique from an elegant Vulcan woman. She and Spock clearly know each other.
She's lovely, Mr. Spock. Who is she?
She is to bring my wife.
Jim, Spock, and Bones go to a ceremonial area for the Kunut Kalifi, meaning marriage or challenge.
In the distant past, Vulcans killed to win their mates.
Jimbo, you sound a little bit turned on by that. A wedding procession arrives, including T'Pring and a grand older woman who Jim excitedly points out as T'Pau, an important Vulcan leader who had turned down a seat on the Federation Council, implying that Spock's family is quite important. I like to personally headcanon that T'Pau isn't just there to officiate, but also because she's actually Spock's grandma. Celia Lovsky, who played T'Pau, was an actress of some note, also the wife of one Peter Lorre. And you may recognize T'Pring as Arlene Martel, the actress who played Tiger in several episodes of Hogan's Heroes, as well as other shows from the time like I Dream of Jeannie and Bewitched. The ceremony begins, but suddenly T'Pring stops everything, invoking the Kalifi, the challenge. By Vulcan right, she is permitted to choose a champion to fight for her hand, and she chooses... Kirk?
I dream of Montaigne, please.
One of the men in T'Pring's party, Stonn, is outraged since he wants T'Pring for himself, but T'Pau is like, shut your ass up, she didn't choose you! Also, Stonn's actor, Lawrence Montaigne, had already appeared in Star Trek as the Romulan officer Decius in Balance of Terror. He actually reprised the role of Stonn in a fan film in 2007. Then T'Pau offers Jim an out, since he's not a Vulcan and not bound to their ways. Jim, however, wants the chance to impress such an important figure and agrees to fight, hoping to just knock Spock out without causing him any real harm. However, it's only revealed to him after agreeing to the terms that Jim finds out that the fight is to the death. Kind of a shit move, T'Pau.
So I'm sitting there, barbecue sauce on my titties.
The fight begins, and despite the blood fever, Spock quickly proves to be the more fearsome warrior, with William Shatner's stunt double just barely dodging Spock's lerpa, a Vulcan weapon that is... just a scotch phallic? Not only is Jim at a major disadvantage strength-wise, but the Vulcan atmosphere is extremely hot and dry, untenable for human anatomy. The arid atmosphere weakens Kirk considerably. Bones calls a timeout so he can give Kirk a triox injection to stave off the effects of the climate, in order to give Jim a fair chance against Spock. T'Pau agrees to it. Kirk and Spock start off again, this time with the An-Woon, which, when leveraged right, can be used like a lasso or a flail. Again, Spock proves the superior fighter, knocking Jim to the ground. They roll around on top of each other a bit... I think we finally reached the climax... of the episode. Spock finally pins Jim, wraps the An-Woon around his neck, and strangles him. Until...
Get your hands off of him, Spock. He's dead.
At the horror of having killed his best friend, Spock overcomes the blood fever, the effects of the Pon Farr alleviated. Bones beams up with Jim's body, and Spock confronts T'Pring. She explains that she didn't want to be the wife of a legend such as Spock has become amongst the Vulcan people, and instead wanted to spend her life with Stonn. If Kirk had won, he would have let T'Pring go. If Spock had won, he would have let her go. And even if he didn't release her, she would be left behind on Vulcan with ownership to all of Spock's property, keeping Stonn as a lover regardless. This is the opposite of a no-win scenario. It's a no-lose scenario. Spock has to tip his hat to her cleverness.
Logical. Flawlessly logical.
I am honored.
I'm reminded of the Sherlock Holmes story A Scandal in Bohemia, in which Holmes is thwarted by a woman smarter than him, and he keeps a photo of her out of respect for the way she bested him, and also to keep himself humble. And like T'Pring, Irene Adler only wanted to live freely with the man she truly loved. Before he leaves, Spock, rather passively-aggressively, tells Stonn that he may someday find that having T'Pring may not be so happy a thing as wanting her. 'Cause happiness... isn't just in the having, you know? It's in just being. It's in just fuck me! Heartbroken over having killed his best friend, Spock returns to the ship, telling Bones that he intends on turning himself over to Federation authorities for Kirk's murder.
I intend to offer no defense. Furthermore, I shall order Mr. Scott to take immediate command of this vessel.
Don't you think you better check with me first?
Captain! Jim!
Man got caught simping live in 4K. So it turns out that what Bones actually injected Jim with was a neuroparalyzer that simulated death so that the fight could end without anyone actually dying. Comic messages the Enterprise, telling Kirk that he's been pardoned for disobeying orders, thanks to a good word from T'Pau on his behalf. So, a happy ending all around. What an episode to start off the second season. We've added Deforest Kelley into the opening credits, officially recognizing him as the third main character on the show, and the theme song now has the vocalist. The biggest thing here is, of course, an expansion of the lore we have on Spock's home planet and culture. This is the first episode we hear someone say the Vulcan blessing, live long and prosper. We also see the Vulcan Ta'al, which Leonard Nimoy based on a hand signal used during Jewish rabbis in a prayer called the Shekinah. We also get another conceit to the discrimination Spock has experienced on Vulcan due to his biraciality. When Spock pleads with T'Pau not to make him fight his friend, T'Pau responds,
"It is said, thy Vulcan blood is thin. Are ye Vulcan or are ye human?"
And Spock is forced to prove that he's a rational, emotionless Vulcan by beating the snot out of someone. Theodore Sturgeon's original screenplay had to be toned down a lot by several different writers. For one thing, Spock was supposed to act like a rutting gorilla, pounding his chest and screeching. For another, slavery is apparently totally acceptable on Vulcan, which is, you know, one of the founding planets that make up the Federation, which definitely draws a hard line against owning people. In one draft, T'Pau declared that Stonn is now Spock's property as punishment for his emotional, un-Vulcan-like behavior. There are some people that say that Sturgeon's original vision for Vulcan was based in BDSM culture, and I can believe it. When it comes to gender and gender roles, Vulcan is an interesting case study. How strange and contradictory the role women play in this society. On one hand, you have T'Pau, the matriarchal leader in a community and so highly revered in the Federation that she was offered a seat on the High Council. On the other, you have T'Pring, who is being forced into a marriage that she clearly doesn't want. T'Pring is a much-contested character in Star Trek fandom. While some people really love her and empathize with her motivations, it should come as no surprise that a lot of people think that she's a manipulative bitch, because mean lady no marry Spock, mean lady make Spock fight friend. I think it's a safe assumption that she probably didn't know Spock and Kirk were so close, and if she had, maybe she would have made him fight McCoy instead. McCoy's a racist, he's got it coming.
Now you listen to me, you pointed-eared Vulcan. I don't like that.
Actually, in Sturgeon's original treatment, T'Pring realizes that Kirk is not only Spock's commanding officer, but his best friend, and feels so remorseful about forcing Spock to kill him that she offers to submit to him as his wife on the spot. Queen, don't apologize for hashtag girlbossing. It's hard to see from her perspective because we as the audience love Kirk and Spock too much not to root for them. But the reality of it is, she's being forced to become some man's chattel. T'Pau literally describes T'Pring as property and possession. The only power she has is choosing someone to fight for her hand, and even then, there's no guarantee her champion will win. The Caliphi only offers the possibility that she won't have to marry Spock. She still has no power to refuse marriage. Luckily, T'Pring was crafty enough to work the system so that she could end up with the suitor she chooses. Though in a perfect world, T'Pring would just pull a Merida and choose herself as champion, being all like, "And I'll be fighting for me own hand!" And then she just kicks Spock's butt and pieces off to become the president of Vulcan or whatever. Yeah, I'm definitely Team T'Pring. It's interesting that there are two significant figures conspicuously missing from Spock's wedding. His parents. I wonder if we'll learn more about them and their relationship with Spock sometime in the future. I don't know why I'm being coy. I've already spoiled that. We're definitely going to do that. So, we've talked a lot about T'Pring and Vulcan society, but we haven't actually talked about the core relationship in this episode, Spock and Jim. Jim's the one Spock confides in about his condition, Jim is the one Spock is forced to fight, and Jim is the one who Spock mourns for when he seems to die in his arms. But I thought Spock and Jim deserved their own video. I think there's a lot of colorful commentary we can make about their relationship. And you won't have to wait long for that video because it's coming out 1 week from the release of this one. So, subscribe, smash that like button, leave a comment below about how you think T'Pring is the nastiest skank bitch you've ever met, or call me mommy, whatever butters your egg roll, my liege, and I'll see you in a week.